The Lord be with you.
Good morning
and welcome to St. Philip. It's good to see all of you here today. Some of you know this, some of you have heard it already, but I had COVID last Sunday, could not make it, and I'm glad for Trish Matthews on the last minute to come and preach for you. And boy, that was a good sermon last Sunday that Trish did, and the one that I was going to preach. So you may hear that another time. But glad to have all of you here. A special welcome to those who are visiting. We're glad that you are worshiping with us. And those online, we're glad that you are here worshiping with us online. We have an order of worship. Those online can download this through our website. But let me call your attention to a few things. Some of you will know that this is the first Sunday of the month, and so we are having communion, and that's listed on page 4. What we have, and I hope that everyone in the sanctuary has gotten one of these little cups, pre-cups. There's a little wafer when you tear off the first little cellophane, and then another cellophane you tear off to get to the juice. So that's what people in the sanctuary will be using today. We're not passing the plates of the elements. We're not passing the plate for an offering. That's all back on the table in the back. Those online, we want you to join us with communion. So grab some bread, crackers, some juice, and share with us communion later on in the service. In the sanctuary, and I think online you will see this too, that there is, in our hymnals, on pages 9 through 11, there's some singing parts. Now, Pauline choirs off this month, but Pauline's going to be our leader. She's going to be the cantor, I guess, for us today, and leading us in the prayer of thanksgiving. That's the sung part on pages 9 through 11 in our hymnals. And that's during the prayer of thanksgiving. Those online, I hope that you can see that too, that music, because that's important for you to join in as well. And we invite everyone who believes in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior to partake in the elements. And so please feel free to join us with communion today. On pages 6 and 7, there's some other announcements. Please note those. If you have questions, let somebody know, let an elder know, ask a neighbor, and I'm sure that you can find the right answer. I'm going to kind of be in and out, not trying to gather with you too much, so that you don't get anything that I might have. Although I'm feeling pretty good today. You can, even my voice is better than it was, I think, on Friday when I was here for the 4th of July fireworks. So I think that's all the announcements. Oh, one more. Yes, go ahead, Van. Real loud. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you, sir.
We need
your... I'm sorry?
We need to hear your word.
Yes, and that's what I'm here to do for you. So thank you so much. Appreciate that. And thank you all for prayers and encouragements and through my time of sickness. Everybody in my family's fine, so I was sequestered in a couple of rooms. It was not an easy time to eat by myself for 5 days or so. But that's the way you do it when we have this pandemic. So again, glad to have everybody here. Chuck Lucas is our liturgist. Glad for Chuck to do that. Someone else, I think, is going to bring in some and pour some water. We're glad for that. Let's continue in our worship by passing the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you. And please extend that peace in the way you feel most comfortable. As you find your seats again, please turn to page 1 and there's a call to worship. Before that, we have these fellowship pads in the ends of the pews. Please sign your name, check the boxes, let us know of your attendance today by signing these pads. Let us call one another to worship by reading responsively the call to worship that you find in the bulletin or on your screen. Each one of us is a gospel. May we have spiritual eyes to see heavenly meaning. And let us worship God.
The word of life,
the font of identity,
the table of sustenance. Children of God, welcome home, and I invite you to pray. Holy God, be with us as we worship you, as we come to the table and realize the life and the death and resurrection of your Son, the Christ. Guide us with your word, and may we hear the good news of the gospel that helps us every moment of our lives. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
The first hymn this morning is 610, O for a thousand tongues to sing. Please join us in singing verses 1, 4, and 5.
Please be seated. There are times in our lives when we have made some mistakes. Perhaps we haven't put God in the right place in our lives. Perhaps we have not befriended a neighbor as we should. Now is the time where we can confess our sin before God and one another. And let us do so by reading the prayer of confession printed in the bulletin or on your screen. Let us pray. God of grace and mercy, you have called us beloved, but we have refused to believe it. You have called us to follow, but we have dragged our feet. You give us the promise of your gracious presence, but we forget to look for you until we're backed into a corner. You are all the strength we need, but we exhaust ourselves trying to be in charge. Deliver us from the depths of our despair, O God. Mend our broken hearts and defeated spirits, and teach us how to be your faithful disciples. In Jesus' name, amen. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. These waters of baptism not only claim us and call us beloved, but cleanse us from our sins. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen.
Please be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I invite you to pray. God of wisdom, as we listen to the scriptures read and interpreted, send us your spirit so that we may hear your word with new understanding. Move within us so that we respond in faithfulness for the sake of Christ, our living Lord. Amen. The Old Testament reading today comes from the book of Psalms. It's Psalms 31, verses 21 to 24. It's on page 440 in the Pew Bible. Blessed be the Lord, for he has wondrously shown his steadfast love to me when I was beset as a city under siege. I had said in my alarm, I am driven far from your sight, but you heard my supplications when I cried out to you for help. Love the Lord, all you his saints. The Lord preserves the faithful, but abundantly repays the one who acts haughtily. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Thank you. Well, it's time for young Christians, so that means that Christians of all ages can perk up and listen to understand maybe a different way of the gospel, of the good news today. And so I wanted to share with you two Bibles. As the pastor in the family, I get inherited all the Bibles. I think that's just the way it is, right? And so I have two of my dad's Bibles, and I wanted to read them to you when he was presented this Bible. Presented to Clarence Garris, that was my dad's name, Clarence. Although when he was in the Army Air Corps, they changed his name. Clarence was too much for them, so they called him Gary. So Gary Garris was his name. That kind of rhymed, and so sometimes people call me Gary still. I don't know why, but that's just the way it is. But it's to Clarence Garris from Smyrna, Delaware. That's where my dad was raised, by First Presbyterian Session, Reverend James R. Gailey, pastor, Easter 1937, for faithful work in communicants class. So that's when my dad got one of his first Bibles. And so as I kind of skip through this, you know, it's the King James Version of the Bible, has some, with helps, it says. And so there's some pictures, black and white pictures, and some other things, pictures of paintings and other kinds of things in this Bible. Then the other Bible that I have from my dad, and some of you may know, my dad passed away in 1980, so that's been a few years. But he was very active, as you can tell, in the Presbyterian Church. And so this Bible, he himself put his own initials in, C.E. Garris, January 1962. January 1962. So I was born in 58, so this is 4 years after I was born. And when I flip through this Bible, I don't know if you're able to see it, especially the Gospels, he has underlined words various places throughout the scriptures and the Gospels and in the New Testament and Old Testament. It has some pictures in it. This is the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, but one that he mostly used. And I remember him. He taught Sunday school when I was in elementary school. And I remember him reading the Bible and highlighting and making notes of where different things are. And I just think that's fascinating for me to really not know. I was 22 when my father passed away, but I have things that I know were important to him, especially the scriptures. And for many of us, the scriptures are important. And some write in the Bible and make notes in the Bible. And here's a page in Luke's gospel where he's made 1, 2, 3, 4 of some of the paragraphs, some of the points that perhaps he was teaching or wanted people to understand. And so I just wanted to share that with you because the scriptures are important to us. They shape our lives. And the people that wrote the Gospels especially are very important to us because they were writing a unique perspective, their own perspective of Christ and Jesus and how Jesus can shape our lives. So I wanted to share with all that with you, and thank you for listening. Let's have a prayer together. Will you say these words after me? Dear God, we thank you for your Son, the Christ, and for his life, his death, and resurrection. May we be touched by him today. In his name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. There are two things that I want to share with you before I read this passage that I preach on. First is that this is the beginning of a series of sermons that will deal with the Gospels, especially the Gospels that help us understand Jesus' life. And what I want us to do in this series, in following Sundays, is hear a different translation, a paraphrase, words from others of some of the Gospel stories that we are familiar with, to see how they can shape us in different ways. So throughout the Sundays, Alyssa's going to preach one of the Sundays and let you hear a different voice in the Gospel narrative, and then I'm going to preach others on different voices of the Gospel narrative. So just to let you know that that's coming, and this is the beginning of that. The second thing I wanted to tell you before I read the passage is that this, I read a sermon about a month ago or so by Joseph M. Webb. He's a professor of preaching and communication, and he wrote a book about preaching that I reread again about a month ago. And in that, he gave a sermon in this book that I thought was pretty fascinating to me. And so I've rearranged some of his words, put his words into my own words to preach this sermon. And I just wanted you to know that it's not all me. This is something that I've read in his book. So listen for God's word as we find it in Acts chapter 15. It's verses 36 through 41. After some days, Paul said to Barnabas, "Come, let us return and visit the believers in every city where we proclaim the word of the Lord and see how they are doing." Barnabas wanted to take with them John, called Mark. But Paul decided not to take with them the one who had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not accompanied them in the work. The disagreement became so sharp that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark with him and sailed away to Cyprus. But Paul chose Silas and set out, the believers commending him to the grace of the Lord. He went through Syria and Sicilia, strengthening the churches. And this is the word of the Lord. And I invite you to pray. Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. There was a very interesting movie that came out in 2017 about a boy named Mason. The movie was called Boyhood. I remember hearing about it before it was released and came into the movie theaters, and I was fascinated by this movie because it took 12 years to film. Now, that wasn't by accident. It was on purpose. And what the film wanted to do is show the growth of this boy named Mason and his sisters and the other characters. So for 12 years, this film was filmed. What we see in the film is Mason and his sisters and other characters grow older. In fact, it's reported that Mason, portrayed by Eller Coltrane, not only was 6 years old when they started filming and 18 when they finished, but that he grew 27 inches and had 72 haircuts. One of the haircuts was on the film. The movie is filmed in Texas by a Texan director, Richard Linklater. Boyhood was nominated for 6 Academy Awards, and some of them were included for Best Picture, Best Director. Patricia Arquette won the Best Supporting Actress for her role in Boyhood. Mason, in the movie Boyhood, is a boy that's a daydreamer. And he did some of those typical childhood and teenager things. And throughout the movie, we see him get hooked on video games and draw graffiti. We see his first girlfriend in high school and how he fell in love with photography, and then his very first day in college. But unfortunately, there were some trials for Mason. Mason and his family moved multiple times to various cities around Texas. And at the beginning of the film, his father is an absent father, his biological father. But he moves back close to the family and establishes contact with them to be an influence in Mason's and his sister's life. We see Mason's mother marry twice and get divorced twice. One of those marriages is to a college professor who was an alcoholic and became abusive to the family. But again, what fascinated me in this almost 3-hour film is how Mason grew and grew up, and also how he questions life and wonders what his purpose is in life. There's another story in the Bible about a boy that we read only brief snippets about in the scriptures. In fact, we don't really know the full story, but we can read in between the lines in the scriptures and understand how he faced some challenges, and we know how he became a very important person in the first church in the first century. The boy's name is John Mark. Now, he's first mentioned in Acts of the Apostles. He's mentioned in the passage I preach on, but he's first mentioned in chapter 12 of Acts. He's briefly mentioned in a story about Peter. Peter was in prison. He's released by an angel in the middle of the night. And then that angel helps Peter travel to a house where many people are gathered praying for him. It was the house of Mary, who was referred to as the mother of John, also called Mark. What we gather from this story is that John Mark knew about Peter and James and John and the rest of the disciples, and no doubt had heard the stories of Jesus. He was a part of the first church. He may have even been a teenager at this time, between 14 and 15 years old, when he saw Peter being led to his house. At the end of chapter 12, John Mark shows up again. And what has already taken place at this point in the story is that Saul, the persecutor of the first Christians, has had that dramatic Damascus Road change, conversion. Now he's named Paul. And Paul was taken to Antioch, and there Paul met a man named Barnabas, who we think was a wealthy and generous and well-loved person in the New Testament. And what we read is that Barnabas and Paul took money from the Antioch church to the Jerusalem church. And what we read at the end of chapter 12 is that Barnabas and Paul completed that mission, returned to Antioch, bringing with them John, who is also called Mark. Later on, we'll understand that Barnabas is related to John Mark. Next in the next chapter of Acts, in chapter 13, we read that Barnabas and Paul are commissioned to take a missionary journey to Cyprus, and John Mark went with them to be their assistant. After their time in Cyprus, Barnabas and Paul decide to go on another mission, but we read something very odd in the scriptures. John Mark deserted them or abandoned them and went back to Jerusalem. Nothing else is said about this. We hear no reason why John Mark left Barnabas and Paul, but those two missionaries continued their missionary journeys. So the next time that we hear about John Mark is in the passage that I read to you today in chapter 15 of Acts. And what we read in this passage is basically that a wonderful missionary duo pair breaks up, all because Barnabas wanted to take John Mark on the next mission. Paul said no. In fact, Paul was so intense and adamant that John Mark should not go with them that it seems that John Mark was the reason why Barnabas and Paul parted ways. Was Paul still angry at John Mark and how he deserted them earlier on a previous missionary journey? Was there another encounter that maybe they had between Paul and John Mark? Well, the fact is, we don't know. But this is not the last time we hear about John Mark. Now, up to this point, we think about 10 years or so, 10 or 12 years have gone by. And John Mark may have been in 27, 28 years old. And then another 10 years pass. And John Mark is reaching 40 years old, and Paul has become one of the greatest missionaries of all time. And Paul gets thrown into prison, and he writes letters. He wrote a letter to the Colossians and a letter to a person named Philemon. And at the end of both of those letters, Paul mentions John Mark's name. Here's what we read in Colossians. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, as does Mark, the cousin of Barnabas. At the end of the letter to Philemon, we read, Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greeting to you, and so does Mark. And then there's just one other reference to John Mark in the Bible. It's in 2 Timothy, chapter 4. Here's what we read. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is useful to me in ministry. Now, somehow there's been a dramatic change that has taken place between Paul and John Mark. Now, Paul wants John Mark to be close to him because he's useful. What happened? Did Paul write John Mark reflecting on his intense reaction that John Mark should not go with them on another journey? Did John Mark reach out to Paul after a few years and try to settle the differences between them? The reality is that we don't know how they reconciled. But this is not the end of the story of John Mark. Most scholars believe that Paul died between the years of 65 and 70. And at this time, we know that the Romans were on a rampage. They concentrated their rage towards a little country called Palestine, where both Jews and Christians lived. It's the place where Pilate and Herod oversaw the crucifixion of Jesus. The Roman army destroyed the city of Jerusalem and the Jerusalem temple, Jewish temple. Jews were slaughtered. Christians fled. The year 70 was not a good year for Jews and Christians. What some biblical writers and scholars believe what happened around this time is that there was a need for someone to step up and begin writing about the life of Jesus for the very first time. It needed to be a seasoned Christian, one who knew about the Christian life and Jesus and the message that Paul and the other disciples were spreading for the last 30 years. What is believed is that this veteran Christian did is gather some parchments, some collections of Jesus' sayings of words that he might have said, and this person probably had copies of Paul's letters and knew Paul's theology. What this person did was write a short account of Jesus' life. It wasn't his full life. It didn't include Jesus' birth, but it was enough to make believers in other communities. And then others began to write their own gospel. The first gospel writer was John Mark. John Mark wrote the Gospel of Mark, and then the Gospels of Matthew and Luke used Mark's pattern when they were writing their account of Jesus' life. The one who deserted Paul and Barnabas, is the one that broke up this missionary pair, is the one who began the gospel movement. John Mark went on to write the first gospel ever written. Now, for me, this is a story of someone who made a few mistakes, perhaps, in life, but then came full circle. It ranks up there with others that we know that have overcome adversity and made an impact on our world, like Albert Einstein, who didn't speak for the first 3 years of his life, or Thomas Edison, that failed between 1,000 and 10,000 times before he invented the light bulb, or Walt Disney, who was fired from his first job at the Kansas City Star after his newspaper editor told him that he didn't have enough imagination or creativity. John Mark was the first to write the story of Jesus. He called it a gospel, which means the good news. And Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, they all made it into our Bible. And we all know that John Mark from our Bible is just a patchwork of stories. We really don't know a lot about him, but he went on to help us understand the gospel message, the very first written story of Jesus' life. We can see in the character Mason in the movie Boyhood as he moves through life from 6-year-old to a teenager moving to college. There's a patchwork of scenes in the movie where we see different things that shape Mason. To be honest, some of those scenes are uncomfortable for us parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles. We would rather not have our children, grandchildren, or nieces or nephews go through some of the things that Mason does. He's bullied in a boys' bathroom in middle school. He takes his first beer with a group of older boys that say derogatory things about women and gays. We see Mason's sister, who seems to get things, so many things right, while Mason struggles. But there are some good things too. There's an influence in Mason's life, a high school photography teacher, a scene where an assistant manager of a restaurant tells Mason's mother how much that she had impacted him. There's even a church scene where his dad and stepmother take Mason and his sister to church along with their stepparents. The patchwork of life shapes Mason, and I'm confident that's what happened to John Mark too. What I hope in these sermons this month will help us understand how the gospel writers can shape our lives and how we can in turn shape other lives as well. Life is a patchwork of many different experiences, and those who have written the words of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John want Jesus' words to shape our lives. The different versions, the translations, the paraphrases of the gospel stories can shape us and influence our life. And I can't wait to share with you what others wrote, and I hope that you will be shaped in a different way too. Thanks be to God, and I invite you to pray. Holy God, be with us as we understand how the words in the scriptures shape our lives and call us to faithfulness. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. And I invite you to pray. Gracious God of love, we are grateful that you have revealed yourself to us and loved us by calling us your children. You have called us precious in your sight, helped us to be a reflection of your love, and bound us together by love that does not let us go. We come to you, O God, weary and carrying heavy burdens. Some of us bear the yoke of illness. Some bear the yoke of loss and grief. Some bear the yoke of caring for those who cannot care for themselves. Some bear the yoke of unemployment or underemployment. Some bear the yoke of hunger. Some bear the yoke of homelessness. Some bear the yoke of oppression and marginalization, of violence, of anger, of depression, of addiction. For these and for so many other yokes, dear God, we pray for rest. We pray for healing. We pray for release. We pray for wholeness. On this holiday weekend, we recognize that our nation also bears many burdens. There is mistrust of our leaders. We seem rarely to find ways to work together for the common good. We continue to see those among us who suffer and languish. We lose our children to senseless shootings and our youth to suicide. We fixate on what divides us rather than on what brings us together as one people. Remind us this weekend of our calling. Remind us of our common creed. Remind us that people are created equal. Inspire us to ensure that all of your children enjoy life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Help us to be profoundly grateful for our freedom and security, to never take these gifts for granted, and to use them for the betterment of all. God of all life, may peace and justice fill our land and the whole world. We pray for places around the world where people are victimized, where safety is threatened, where freedoms are denied, where life is treated as anything less than sacred. Especially this morning, we pray for families of migrants who died in a trailer in San Antonio this past week. We pray for those sick with COVID, those recovering from after surgery, and traveling this weekend. Surround us with the assurance that you are watching after these and others, and help us to know where we can step up and help and assist those in need. Gracious God, grant us the yoke of Christ. Bind us together, tether us by your love, and guide us by your presence, so that we can live the good news of the gospel in our words and our lives. We pray this prayer and all the prayers in our hearts in the name of your Son, the Christ. Amen. We continue in our service to give our tithes and offerings. Again, we're not passing the plate. People online can give through our website. Let us now consider how we can give our tithes and offerings.
I invite you to pray. Generous God, you have blessed our lives with gifts, both visible and invisible. We offer our gifts in gratitude to build up your kingdom in the world. Bless all that we give to make a difference in the lives of others, for the sake of Christ our Lord. Amen.
And please be seated. The table is before us. The elements are ready. Now we have the opportunity to come together as one in Christ and share the bread and the cup. Friends, this is the Lord's table, and our Savior invites all those who trust in him to share in this feast. Gracious God, we praise your holy name, giving thanks to you with our lips and our lives, for the power and the mystery of your word by which you created us and called us to yourself, we give you thanks. For the power and the mystery of your word by which you took flesh and lived among us, through your Son Jesus the Christ, we give you thanks. For the power and the mystery of your word by which you chose common people to write the Gospels and who helped form the church to be the body of Christ in the world, we give you thanks. Therefore, with all your faithful people from every time and place, we join with the whole creation and lift our hearts in joyful praise. Faithful God, we offer you our praise and thanks as we return to you these holy gifts of bread and cup. Remembering our Lord's command to take and eat, we ponder the mystery of his promise that in this meal we are joined to him and to one another as a holy people, united in heaven and earth. We offer you our praise and thanks for Jesus the Christ, who took flesh and lived among us, was baptized for our sins, taught us your way of truth, loved us in our lovelessness, and died that we may have life. And now, O God, we celebrate with great joy your Son, the Christ, and his presence with us in this feast, and his promise of a new creation as we affirm the mystery of faith. God of grace and power, you invite us to share in mysteries that are beyond our understanding. In simple trust, we seek the transforming power of your Spirit on this church and this community, that through our lives and our living out the gospel, that by the miracle of your grace, we may be united to Christ and to one another in one body, one spirit, and one faith. This sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving we offer to you, gracious God, through your Son, the Christ, our Lord and Savior, who lives in unity with you and the Holy Spirit, God in one, to eternity and all. Amen.
Amen.
And now hear us, O God, as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Take, eat. Do this in remembrance of me." And in a similar way, Jesus took the cup after the supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do this in remembrance of me." And whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the death of our Lord until he comes again. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us now take these elements. And let us pray together the prayer after communion, which is printed in your bulletin or on your screen. Let us pray together. Holy God, we have been blessed as a community not only to hear Scripture read and proclaimed, but to gather at your table. Sustained body, mind, and soul, send us out into the world to share the gospel with both words and actions, so everyone we meet encounters your embodied word. Amen. And leave this place understanding that we all have a patchwork of moments in our lives that shape us and form us as Christians. As we reflect on that this week, let us be guided by the scriptures in all that we say and do, and be united in our message that Christ is Lord and Savior. Go in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
you can. I'm Ann. So it's nice to have you. It's a pretty small club today, but I think a lot of people are on the road.
Holiday weekend.
Yes.
Well, that's
so much good.